Hello and welcome, everybody. This is a CTMU Compatriots meeting, first Braintrust episode. We have Mr. Tommy Golaboy, we have Mr. John Ohm, and we have Mr. Coleman Trapp. All the two of them making their debut on, perhaps on YouTube. Although John Ohm's no stranger to doing podcast. No, Digital Archaeology is Coleman Trapp's channel, and I urge you to watch this because he's done so many hundreds of hours, if not thousands of hours of work on his video. And John Ohm has been party to podcasts before. And this is the first Braintrust episode called The Interdisciplinary Aspects of the CTMU. And we'll speak to both John and Coleman, get their rundown of their discipline, their field of study, and then we'll tie it back into the CTMU. So anything anybody wants to say to start it with?
I'll just say to you, Greg, I'm so glad you put this group together.
Thank you.
Yeah, to really get a philosophy group in essence about the CTMU and tying it to all of our, you know, passions in life. It's really, I appreciate it a lot.
We go further together, I think. If you go it alone, it's a tough slog. But if we tie it back in, and all of us now are members of the CTMU Compatriots, which I hope will grow and burgeon in the future. So, good. Thank you for that, John. So I'll start with you, Coleman, if that's all right. Do you have any thoughts to, if you were to quickly explain your research to somebody? I almost called your research in a paper biblical techniques. Biblical techniques, because it's so amazing, and the imagery that you carry, the love of the Hebrew language. Would you like to explain your work in a verbal summary?
Yeah. So everything we know is through pattern recognition. That's how we can have anything. You know, you throw seeds down and next season there's plants there. And over maybe a few hundred years, you gather this intuition about, you know, that you can plant a seed and a tree grows out of it. Like, we kind of take these things for granted. And the scientific method is similar. Like, you can see a pattern multiple times, but you don't know if it's a pattern. You don't know if you're actually seeing a pattern or if you're deceiving yourself. So you would create an experimental environment to see if the pattern continues into the experimental environment. So, yeah, I mean, this is the source of intuition, right? It's like you might subconsciously have seen something and then you see it again and again, and all of a sudden you're like, is it true that if I wash my hands after surgery, it's less likely that my patients will get sick? So if we're building our intuition based on pattern recognition, then if we found the source of all patterns, would it seem counterintuitive to us?
Yeah.
So I think that's what my work is delving into this, what I believe is the blueprint of reality. And reality is a big word. It might just be the blueprint of the human psyche, right? Because I'm bound by the human psyche. I don't know what I'm actually looking at.
Yeah.
But this blueprint, it looks counterintuitive. It doesn't look scientific. It looks poetic. It looks artistic. And I think it might be the source of our scientific intuition.
And you think that the Bible is this blueprint?
It's the Bible in relationship to the number pi. So it's the Bible when converted to a series of numbers, and those numbers related to their position in pi. It creates a kind of an abstract. Okay, so every verse, every word of the Bible has a numerical value. And so because of that, because every number appears infinite times in pi, every verse and every word of the Bible is somewhere in pi. Okay. And that has to be right, because every number appears in pi. But the real mystery here is where the numbers appear, right? It's like if you have a verse about sowing that's like sowing seed that's in Genesis, and then you have a verse about sowing seed that's in the book of Deuteronomy.
Yeah.
These are separated in the Bible by thousands of verses. But if you take their numerical values and search them in pi, and they're right next to each other, right, then you get this idea that these two are in relationship with each other. And so when I first started to notice this and pick it apart with the entire Bible, all 31,102 verses, this beautiful system blossomed out of pi that kind of shows human biology and physics and energy efficiency and history.
Yeah. It's fun. And you liken pi to, since it's the it's number of a circle, right? Essentially pi is like, I forget what relation
it's, it has a relationship. Circle. Yeah.
And then a circle is the symbol for a seed. Is that correct?
Well, I mean, when we look at seeds like a mustard seed, it's spherical often. Yeah. A human egg is circular. So that's one way of looking at it. The word seed is very deeply connected with pi. It's like if reality is a tree, like the tree of life, then what is the seed for the tree?
Yeah.
Could be pi.
Now, with these theories and with John Ohm, these are theories that are what the establishment would dub pseudoscience, or they would, or like with John Ohm's founder, what John Ohm studies in German medicine, it's Reike Gerdheimer is known as a pseudoscientist. Chris Langen of the CTMU is known as a pseudoscientist. It's like the establishment is waging war against about divergent ways of thinking, or ways of thinking that challenge their truth directly. Do you see your work as kind of a vanguard sort of a field, or a way that do you know any authors before you that has come to the same realization that you've come to?
Yeah, a lot of authors. I mean, a lot of the tradition of commentary, scriptural commentary going back thousands of years has kind of pointed in the same direction. And while, this almost like witch hunt of pseudoscience has gone on for the last 30 or 40 years, I feel like there's a new humility that's burgeoning, especially since COVID. Like I'm seeing scientists embedded in the mainstream that are starting to ask questions, because science has a purpose, right? It has to have a purpose for society, right?
Yeah.
And we invoked the scientific method to solve specific problems. And because we are thousands of years into the future, we've manifest wonders, but the most basic questions are still left unanswered. I think we've hit a tipping point where people are starting to go. I mean, a simple example is Michael Levin's work on DNA, right? In the early 2000s, DNA was supposed to hold the secrets of human biology. Then they mapped the whole genome and realized that the majority of questions we have about humans, how humans are formed, is not in the genome. That it's more about morphology and bioelectrics, and the pioneers of those fields were pseudoscientists. And now the man who's heralding this new framework is one of the most respected biologists in the world. So I'm definitely seeing that.
It strikes me that you're on a spiritual quest, as all four of us, I believe, are on a spiritual quest, motivated by God, motivated by faith. That's wonderful. Thank you for spelling out your work for us. We'll get further into it. Getting to Mr. Ohm, you have anything to say, Tommy? Any interjection or anything?
No, not yet.
No, okay, Mr. Ohm. Same question goes to you. A quick verbal summary of your work.
My work is really centering around the German New Medicine, working with people from a German New Medicine point of view and from that lens. And to your point about like pseudoscience with these new ideas, it's really more than an idea. It's a discovery, and it stands on its own. So it really deserves the scientific method to be applied to it. I wish universities would try to falsify these discoveries and these ideas. But they're not really doing that. So it's really kind of a tipping point, like you're saying, and a humility that we kind of have to take it upon ourselves to apply our own rationality, logical deduction, and everything to assess the quality of ideas and everything out in the world. And with my focus on the German New Medicine, I was sort of in the healthcare field of, chiropractic, nutrition, wellness, lifestyle, right? And I was very big on nutrition and eating the right foods, et cetera, detoxing in our toxic world. And my opinion about the nature of health and disease really centered on, it's all about what you put into the body and how you can get rid of the bad things in the body, okay?
Yeah.
And I kind of blew off the germ and new medicine. I'd heard about it earlier in 2014, and I kind of blew it off thinking I had the whole thing figured out at the base level. Then I did go and look into the germ and new medicine in 2017, late 2017, and it really only took about an hour of reading it before I realized, holy crap, this is a major revelation in our understanding of how the body works. And it's really it really becomes common sense and, you know, easy to assimilate when you realize that, you know, there's two halves of biology. There's the mechanistic, nutritional, biochemical half, and then there's the psyche, emotions and experiences. Yeah. And what the germ and new medicine is really showing us is that you can't really understand the phenomenon in biology, specifically organic disease symptoms, without an appreciation and an inclusion of the other half of biology, which is the psyche.
Yeah.
And so really just to like lay down the key points about germ and new medicine, it's talking about how our psyche and our awareness can receive certain kinds of stresses that take us by surprise. They're called biological conflict shocks. And what's so fascinating about these is that they will imprint the brain physically, leaving a lesion, which is called a hammerhead, in the brain over top a specific brain relay that depends on the nature of the conflict shock. Okay, so in our psyche, we have many different kinds of stresses, many things that can take us by surprise, different categories of experience, and depending on what the experience is, that will determine where in the brain this imprint lands, okay, which relay in the brain it lands. And then from there you get an organ-specific, correlated to the brain, cellular adaptation, okay? Yeah. And the purpose of this, it's called a biological program of adaptation. The purpose of it is to galvanize an effort at the level of the psyche, the brain, and the organ to overcome that specific conflict shock. And real short, in summary, disease symptoms, right? Rash, influenza, like a cough, all the internal inflammatory disease processes, the majority of them are simply the consequence of these biological programs of adaptation, where you have this active cellular adaptation response to try to galvanize a overcoming of the problem. And then when you do overcome the problem, then you have this post-conflict healing phase where the body has to reverse that cellular adaptation. Yeah. And for the majority of disease symptoms, that's where you experience the symptoms of disease in this post-conflict healing or restoration phase. Mm. And it's a whole new science of understanding how the body works here. And and it really, with respect to the topic of science, and which I understand to really be a question of causality, what is the cause of the phenomenon? Here we have at last a causal understanding of these phenomenon of the body, of these disease symptoms in the body.
They call that etiology, right, in medicine? Etiology, the development of a disease.
Yeah, that could be a good word to hear. Yeah.
And you almost, I think at one point you said, and I watched your podcast, at one point you said, it's almost like a concentric, these hammerheads, these lesions that are actually biological programs from the brain to the body, are like concentric circles.
They're actually spherical in formation. Hammer called them standing waves. Right here, we're talking about the circle, the sphere, the seed. Yeah, absolutely. All of this is going to connect.
Isn't that the synchronicity? We're talking about pie and the seed with Mr. Trapp's work, and then next thing you know, it's another. It's like a circle drawing operation. It's really the synchronicity is amazing.
Yeah.
When I say that this is pseudoscience. When somebody calls something pseudoscience, my interest is then peaked. This is going to be fascinating, right? If something's going to be out there, it's going to be pseudoscience. It's like Chris Langan has called, like I had a family get together for Thanksgiving. Canadian Thanksgiving is earlier than American Thanksgiving. And one of my cousins was like, nah, I don't really believe in it. And I said, well, what do you think Einstein or Newton or Leibniz was like when their time, they came with these massive discoveries, right? And it's almost like where there's smoke, there's fire. Where they call something pseudoscience now, it's like there's something there.
Yeah, absolutely. It's not going to work anymore to just call something pseudoscience, I don't think.
And like you said, Reiche Gerdhammer was the youngest, the guy that founded German New Medicine, youngest to get his medical license.
Yeah, in the country of Germany. Yeah,
in
I think he
Germany.
still has that title today. Yeah.
So it's almost a war on competency too, as well. It's just, yeah.
Yeah, and
And
you
I
go to
believe.
Wikipedia. Oh, go ahead. Go ahead.
Oh yeah, and I believe Chris Lang has actually said, like, if he presented the his kind of work in the 1920s or earlier, that he would have probably had a better reception because there's so, at least modern academia is so preemptively closed off to the to these kind of ideas. I wanted to ask John, it, on the tack of interdisciplinary applications of the CTMU, what would, let's say I'm walking into a medical school 500 years from now, what would that look like? What would be being taught? What is the general practice? Because I have basically no background in the kind of things that you're talking about.
Oh, well, that's a fascinating question. On the face of it, I can say that we'll be having technologies that can read the brain very easy. Right now, you can use a CT scan to read the brain and assess these hammerheads, their location, as well as their phase. So I was talking about the conflict active phase and the healing phase. These are corresponding in the brain to either a concentric ring formation or sphere of activity. And then when you resolve the conflict and you enter that second restoration phase or healing phase, the brain imprint will turn to edema. So one thing Wikipedia doesn't mention, because they like to say, oh, the brain imprint is just a artifact of the CT technology, which on the face of it, you can disprove. You could say, no, you just take multiple scans at different angles and demonstrate that the lesion is in the same part of the brain. But furthermore, it has a morphological shift. It shifts to edema at a specific point in the person's life. Okay, so it's crystal clear these are real formations. So in the future, what I'm expecting is household items, and it's not even going to be 500 years in the future, but to think that far ahead, yeah, I hope we reach the singularity at that point and really get an understanding of the psyche brain organ connection at this sort of spiritual level that's going to define and change so much of life all throughout, you know. But just even in the near future, we can anticipate a day where you have a household item that reads the brain and can determine and assess, oh, there's a new hammerhead here. Okay. And then what you have with that is a predictive comprehension of the phenomenon of disease. So, for instance, if a hammerhead appears in the sensory cortex governing the outer skin of the left arm, okay, now you know there's a biological cellular process operating on the left arm. And you'd also know that when that hammerhead shifts to edema, okay, when the person resolves a specific kind of conflict in life that imprinted the brain, a separation conflict of either wanting to separate from something or not wanting to separate from something, this problem in life, when they resolve that, the hammerhead's going to shift to edema, and then you're going to get the expression of a rash and potentially a fever expression as well. So you'll have this technology to read the brain. You could read your child's brain, read your own brain, and then you can understand the phenomenon here, and anticipate when it's going to happen. When that individual resolves that conflict, I know that the edema is going to form and the biological manifestation at the level of the organ is going to present. So that's not even far into the future. In fact, you can do that right now, even in lieu of a CT scan, with a comprehensive understanding of the germ of new medicine and the psyche connections here, the psyche correlations. But right now we're working with CT scans. And yeah, you can read a whole person's medical history on a CT scan. So yeah, it's the medicine of the future, as far as I'm concerned. What it looks like in 500 years, I think it'll be very much more to the person. They'll have a natural, innate comprehension of this. We'll come together as a society to help an individual who is conflicted with something in life, okay? To help them overcome that conflict. And then on even on a more spiritual level, we'll understand that all of biology and these disease symptoms are internested into a lifetime, an experience of a lifetime, a story, a journey through life. And now we're going to comprehend an individual on a whole nother level of appreciation for the life of the person and how that's interwoven into nature. So really, in a kind of biggest sense, we're integrating the individual, the biology, with nature and with like the spiritual purpose of life, a person's purpose and values in life. So what does that look like? It looks like harmony. It looks like reunion with nature in a way that is just harmonious. like a golden age or something.
It's really a holistic way of viewing these things, right? A spiritual and a holistic way. It's fast. I'd like to get to Mr. Trapp. I know Mr. Trapp. Very good, John. I know Mr. Trapp has ideas about technology. Mr. Ohm was talking about how this technology will scan our brains and it'll be a household technology. And I even wrote an article talking about how the CTMU can produce these architectural design technologies, that if you take certain principles out of the CTMU, if you take constraints of manifold, if you take the mathematical space it produces, then some of these technologies, it's like, how many technologies do we use Cartesian space for the X, Y, Z axis? Laying in constraints of manifold will be even that on steroids, right? But you had, Mr. Trapp, you had specific ideas for technology coming out of your research. Do you want to mention what those are?
Yeah, I actually see a lot of synergy between what I was imagining and what John Rome is speaking on, not the specific brain scanning technology, but the, because I, yeah, that's, I don't know enough about that, but I know that we are programmable. And yeah. I think one of the greatest mysteries in scripture is the parable of the sower, where the disciples asked Jesus why he speaks in parable. And he kind of caps off this whole deep lecture on the phrase ospiron ton logon spidi, which means the sower soweth the word. And he's talking about how language is a seed and it can be implanted into the brain and it'll bear fruit. And language is a stimuli. Human language is, you know, natural language is what I'm speaking, but you could see the sunrise as a type of heavenly language. Any kind of symbolism that we see in the world, you know, walking through the forest, hearing the birds, smelling, like all this stimuli is like a natural language. And what is these offensive that are creating the hammer, what are they called?
Hammerheads.
Yeah. That's almost like a word. It's almost like a, it's almost like they're hearing a curse or something that's implanting into them. You know, you get injured, right? Let's say you get hit. There's no hit that's actually happening. It's being transformed into electrical stimuli that's being decoded by the brain. So it has to come back to language at some point. Mm-hmm. And so there's certain things that are getting hooked into people's brains. And while there might be a physical technology that scans these places, and maybe there's a physical technology that can dissipate these standing waves. One of the things that John Ohm brought up is kind of looking at the bigger scale, like what would need to happen in society to make it where these offenses are happening less in the first place. What are these hammer herds on the level of society? Like what is a standing wave which within a community that when that's dissipated, then the people in the community have because the brain's a model, right? It models reality. That's what it's there for. So when I think of my technology, like I would like it to, like it would be cool if it was a physical technology, but my intuition is that it's not. I think it's a software more than a hardware. I think it's realizing that the human body is a machine beyond belief. I don't know how familiar y'all are with the field of cybernetics, but computers were created to interface with human biology. And that might be beyond the scope of this question, but I think that there's a certain language or stimuli that might be able to dissipate a hammer herd or something that is deeply embedded, some social misunderstanding, right? Like we like words have power, and these beliefs we have about reality, I think create dysfunction in society. Like words like individuality, freedom, free will, like people are very invested into these words. And I think they manifest as sickness, because at the end of the day, it's all ideology that's separating from like that state of pure submission and surrender that brings absolute joy.
Yeah, like I know people in my life, and it gets to John Ohm's thing about how the psyche and the lifetime of an individual is really what we're the holistic view that we're looking at. I've known people that they talk like they don't want to live. They have passive suicidal ideation, and then the next thing you know, some bad illness manifests in their life, you know. So I do believe it. If you're looking at your technology as a trap, like it's a software, that's thinking like Elon Musk in a certain way. Like Elon Musk thinks like that, right? I believe language is a software, and maybe faith is the most powerful software. That I think in all this, faith in Christ is really what drives me the most. It's a language that I call it the Christ metaphysic that spurs me on, and maybe the personal relationship that one person has with God when they pray, opening up that line of communication. I think that really helps people out. Is there anything you'd like to say, Tommy?
Yeah, I was going to ask Coleman the same thing I asked John, is that if all of this is encoded in the Bibles and in the Bible and the numerical relationships between the various passages in that text, what would, let's say, same thing I asked John, I'm like, what would in 500 years, if I walk into a seminary or a theology lecture, what is the kind of thing that they'd be talking about with respect to biblical studies?
So in the year 2523, yes. Man, I just see so much fun and adventure. I feel like that's something that our generation has been starved for. Other generations have had these massive things to explore, and it feels like people are fighting for smaller and smaller scientific discoveries, smaller and smaller pieces of fame. But yeah, I think we humans love pattern. I think humans love art. Humans love seeing pieces click together. I mean, maybe that's too general. Maybe there's people who wouldn't say that about themselves, but on a deep biological level, like, the brain is there to reduce surprise, in the words of Carl Friston. So 500 years from now, if planet Earth, you know, I'm not opposed to the way that science is going. I don't necessarily think that the world is on like this crash course towards destruction. I think that we are experiencing growing pains, and that there will be a lot of humbling, and that we'll have to face where we've been wrong, and certain things will have to die out like a tree falling in the forest. Mm-hmm. But I like this idea of like building supercomputers and creating wonderful worlds. And I think AI is, I think it's very natural. I don't even think AI is necessarily a human thing. I think we're just manifesting the intelligence of nature. Yeah, I don't know what the world will look like in 500 years, but I hope it's, I hope we're a little less arrogant as a people.
I think democratization of these processes is really the most important thing. Like, one of the key selling points for me for the CTMU is the fact that Langan says his paper, though rejected by the university, has been downloaded millions of times. That's metaphysics by democracy. I think with AI, I think Jordan Peterson, his brother-in-law, for his, John Keller, I think his name was, who talked about how AI will advance, so computer technology will advance, but it'll be democratized so that you have a pocket, something like a cell phone in your pocket is a way of democratizing AI and supercomputers to every person, right? So I think that's, I'm actually very optimistic. There's a lot to be, when you know the forces arrayed against kind of good, when you know the forces of evil, but yet you still have optimism. That's what we should look over the horizon, is that we have our fields of research we can study, and it's just, it provides a lot of hope, right?
Yeah. And then to John, what do you think about this idea, which I've heard, is that disease in the context of the CTMU can be understood as a kind of non-terminal programming, that you have this non-physical essence which has this teleological destiny, and that everything you do becomes its own proto-universe, which is trying to direct you towards a certain end, which could be manifest, you know, as that the disease which you've contracted is in some way is like contributing to your destiny, that's trying to tell you something.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's the way to begin to understand it. There's a purpose or a meaning to these biological programs where disease symptoms are really internested or explained as consequences of the biological program. So if you think of a disease just by itself, you know, when you begin to understand the disease as a consequence or a part of the biological program, then you go ask the question, what's the purpose or the meaning of the biological program, the adaptation in the body? And it's absolutely to bring you to an end. It's in a very basic, you know, in the German medicine sense, it's about conflict resolution, okay? Specific to the individual's experiences in life, they had a conflict. The biological program is designed to help you try to overcome that conflict in life. So there's a meaning and intelligence to these biological programs where the expressions of them can appear consequentially as disease symptoms. So, and it goes to this idea of like, even the term a biological program kind of implicates purpose here and programming as well, okay? And so, yeah, like the psyche is the programmer writing the software for the hardware of the brain. And so, and it also, something very interesting that you brought up, Coleman, and what you were talking about is about the brain being there to mitigate against shock, or the words, I think you used a more specific word there, the unknown, or, but yeah, it's about this experience, in a sense, not being able to be comprehended within our syntax or our ability to comprehend the experience. It's a shock, it's unknown, it's surprising, I think is the word. And from that surprise, we're trying to gain a comprehension of the problem. Okay, it surprised us, it landed in the brain, it kicks on this archaic biological program, shifting the psyche, the brain, and the organ to try to bring us to another level so that we can resolve the problem. And resolving the problem is about comprehending the problem, understanding it, navigating it with a greater sense of ability. And so, and then when we do that, it's like we're upgraded in a sense. We had this biological program running to overcome this problem. We overcome the problem. Then we go into this healing phase, right? Part of the second half of the biological program. But then when we're all the way through it, we have this upgrade in our psyche, brain, and organ. We're more capable of understanding what previously took us by surprise and able to navigate our future better. So yeah, there's definitely, and even to the point of a seed or a word implanting, right, into the brain, we're trying to understand the essence of what took us by surprise to grow, to evolve. So yeah, I mean, there's so much to be said on all of this, and it's such an exciting paradigm of understanding biology, because it really does connect us into teleology and purpose. And that's where you have to begin to go to really even heal the body, okay, in a very pragmatic, practical sense. So there's a incentive here to bring us to this higher level of teleology and purpose. So yeah, absolutely.
That's I'm really happy you guys are in the group, the CTMU Compatriots, and to watch your work unfold with your individual initiative and interests is just, it's heartwarming, and I'm glad to bring you guys together. There'll be much future, we can do future episodes too, that as we go along and as we integrate further. Do you have any questions further for them, Tommy, or should I go to one of mine?
Go ahead. Yep.
Okay. So, this one's to Mr. Coleman. With all this being said, you have this idea of, you think it's more of a software, and that the Bible actually has a lot of uncounted basically it's like untallied software, basically, right? Like you're saying the Bible contains pi, it contains infinite variations, numerical sequences that overlay and map together quite well. What do you see as the future if you carry your work furthest, if you carry your work to its natural conclusion? What is your vision of the future for your field of research for humanity?
I think it's wonderful. I think it's a future that involves wonder. And that word wonder has this other meaning, which is like, I wonder what it'll be like. I think that that mystery. Okay, so the word Aleph, the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, is spelled Aleph Lamed Pei. And Aleph is a one. That's its value. But if you spell it out, Aleph Lamed Pei, each one of those letters has its own value, and you can add all those up and it's equal to 111. So there's this like oneness to Aleph that's pretty clear.
Yeah.
If you spell Aleph backwards, and this is kind of how the programming language works, it's like a language that can be morphed and molded, and it doesn't lose its meaning. With English, that doesn't work. You could take an English sentence and rearrange it and it means something totally different. But part of the miracle of the text of the Bible is and this is something that rabbis have been doing for millennia, is finding deep meaning in rearranging the letters. Like, you can rearrange Bereshit, the first word of the Hebrew Bible, and it will say all these things about creation. And that's given me a lot of confidence, because in this like wordplay, it's not like I found like Scientology or something. It's like it comes back around to things that I think already have merit. And so that's why I can play with a word like Aleph and reverse it to get the word Pele, which means wonder. And the word Aleph, I actually have this in the video, the Hebrew as a programming language, so this might be redundant to y'all, but in the word Aleph, there's almost like this word picture, right? Where El is the name of God, and the Pe at the end is like an open mouth. Okay, the letter P in Hebrew is a representative of a mouth. That's why it's interesting that the word pi in Hebrew means mouth, because it's like pi is like the mouth of God through which like the patterns of creation are being spoken out. So Aleph, when it's spelled L, like Aleph Lamed is L, that means God, and the mouth is open, so it's like God speaking. So Aleph is like the one speaking. You reverse it, and that Hebrew letter P actually closes, so it's like the mouth closing. And it creates the word Pele, which means wonder, which is like the unknown, the darkness. If you look at the electromagnetic spectrum, right, it's like the things that are dark on the bounds of the frequencies that we see as light. We see those as dark, but they're not actually dark. We just don't have sensors. Okay, so that's what I believe darkness is it's misunderstanding. So I think the future is inherently darkened. I don't know that it's like it's beyond, there's like a wall there where I know what I hope it is, right? I know the work I have to do, the seeds that I have to sow. No eye has seen, no ear has heard what the Lord has prepared for those who love him. So that picture I just showed you, where the one is the mouth open, like to speak, and it's equal to one Aleph, and you flip it around and it's Pele, and it's the mouth closed, right? That's like a one and a zero. And I think that one possibility of where this could go, of many, many possibilities, is using this understanding to create generative experiences, right? I know not everybody's a fan of like VR and where all that stuff is going. There's a lot of about that that spooks people. But from an educational perspective, if you could put on some kind of goggles and be able to explore pi, because when I'm exploring it, I'm just seeing numbers and connecting it. I have a document where I've just gone into the first 1,000 digits. This pi goes into like the first 600,000 digits, and I've mapped all that, but the first 1,000 digits are where I've really put in work. And so when I look at the numbers, it's almost like the movie The Matrix, where the numbers are coming down and sort of like read it. When I'm looking at the first 1,000 digits of pi, like I can see like, oh, this is the blueprint of the human body. Like the first 32 digits are clearly from head to toe of the human body. where each verse connects, each number connects to different verses that have to do with the head and the heart and the solar plexus and the belly. It's beautiful. So that's like the most two-dimensional I think it will ever be. I think in the future there will be a way to put Pi into the software, maybe with the help of artificial intelligence, and get to step into this dimension and walk around this like this other dimension that's like the one that manifests the one we're in. But that also just might be what happens when we die. Maybe that's not for this plane. I don't know, but I know that the thing that got me into this in the first place, the thing that inspired me to start digging at all, was a desire to know the future of health, the future of healing. That was my prayer. That was my drive that led me there. And I studied global religions. I was on tour with a band for 5 years straight, and I would just sit in the back of our little Sprinter van, just studying everything I could about biohacking and health and the history of health. And I was like studying world religions and psychology to understand, what the future of health is. And so I think that's, if I put it simply, that's what my hope for my work would be, is that it makes humans thoroughly adapted to this life, mentally, physically, and spiritually.
Wonderful. Yeah. I could almost see like a, you know how the Bible is a hyperlinked document. You found like a new numerical way of hyperlinking it even further. And it's fascinating. I wish you the best of luck with your endeavor and your research. I really do. Mr. Ohm, you have the same question to you, and you've kind of spoken of, you think that there's going to be, it reminded me, I don't know if you've seen the movie Elysium. It's a sci-fi movie where they have like this, the rich humans have this tank that they just step in and it cures all their diseases by scanning them and going over them. You said that there could be 500 years from now, let's say, a device that scans the brain, scans different parts of the body, and can tell you what's going on. Is this the extent of what you're looking for in the future of your work, or what's the vision for the future for your studying the German New Medicine and your work as an editor?
Yeah, I personally hope, and this actually might sound a little strange, but I kind of hope that a technology couldn't possibly be existed to just dissolve these hammer herds from the brain. And the reason why I say that is because they're way too significant and meaningful to the individual's life. All right. And so I don't anticipate a way to dissolve the hammer herd from the brain. And if there is some attempt to do that, I don't think it's going to lead to amicable results. And because I think what is really being called here is a way to, like Coleman was saying, really understand and adapt to our life experience at the psyche, brain, and organ level, and to grow as living biological organisms, not to just mediate our disease symptoms so that we can get on life as normal. It's a calling to evolve. And so I don't anticipate a technology to heal us, some kind of sci-fi kind of approach to health. I anticipate a psyche evolution, a kind of treating the psyche as a technology in its own right. And there is where I see it connecting with the CTMU, because the CTMU is giving us an overarching kind of theory of everything, which includes at last the psyche, or the awareness, the point of awareness, not just the ectomorphic linear way of mapping reality. You have to implicate the human being, or the being, the identity. And the psyche is the technology that, when we really biohack it, in a word, or make use of it, or grow into it and evolve it, I mean, it's nature's instrument for us to use. We're not only going to achieve health, I think that's going to be kind of the first thing that we really figure out is, okay, life without disease, what a wonderful thing. But at that point, we're going to be accessing the psyche in a way that really is how it integrates with our reality and how reality presents to us. Okay, so there's the singularity of the technocratic kind of dystopian world, and then the human singularity, and they're kind of mirrored in a sense. You have virtual reality on one hand, and then you have reality on the other, and reality is a psyche to environment mapping integrated whole. Okay, so imagine actually living your virtual reality dream. Okay.
Yeah.
So creating a dream, okay, and living and navigating life, because life is a dream, as many ancients would have it. You know, we call it a self-simulation now with the CTMU, but really, if you think about it, a dream, and then you ask, how do I get lucid in this dream? I mean, the sky's the limit, right? Yeah. So that's how I see things happening. I think we kind of agree with that would be the great kind of advance, is the technology of the human soul, is one way to put it.
Wow. Yeah, it's very, very metaphysical.
Yeah, that's beautiful. And that gets to what I kind of want to talk about in the second half or so of our conversation, is what this talk is titled is the interdisciplinary applications of the CTMU. So this can be in your own bodies of work, in your general things, but let's say not 500 years from now, Don, some kind of abstract future, but let's say the next 5 to 20 to 25 years, what does the instructional material and the way that we kind of elaborate on various disciplines, what does that look like in the near to medium term?
You can answer. Yeah, I'm trying to actually gauge your question. So just generally speaking, interdisciplinary, I mean, I think of all the different disciplines of philosophy, science, and then you know, what does that look like in 5-10 years, ostensibly with recognition of the CTMU and growing our understanding of the CTMU. You know, if I bring it into the germ of new medicine specifically, it goes to this idea of really being able to, it's like a growth of awareness and ability. So not just awareness of our biology within the context of the psyche and our life story and the key moments of shock or surprise that are making themselves manifest biologically in very real ways. Awareness of these moments of surprise is really kind of the germ of new medicine work to give us a comprehension of what's going on in the body. But also with respect to including the CTMU into this interdisciplinary approach to the psyche, it's really a newfound ability to navigate life with greater joy and greater capacity. And I think there's, you know, people have been trying to do this in terms of, like, you know, manifestations and kind of, I guess there's the law of attraction trope, which is sort of an oversimplification of what is burgeoning in people's beliefs of, like, I can control my reality to a greater degree than I currently do. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I think that's really where it's going to lead. The CTMU is going to kind of give us the map or the framework to begin to understand, well, how does reality navigation, I don't even know if I use the word reality creation, but perhaps navigation is a more humble way to go about it. Navigating our experiences is a term that I like to use. How can we do that? So it's actually, I think there's going to be a skill that develops with the CTMU and the German New Medicine's appreciation for the psyche, brain, organ, biological system. And something that gives us a greater sense of control over, first and foremost, our body and health as to our desire for life, and then mapping out further to relationships, you know, security, harmony on a social level, right? Yeah. To the point where I think our solutions will actually be a lot easier than we ever dreamed. Once we, you know, grapple with this new skill, which isn't a new skill, it's something that we've been trying to grapple with for all of history, as long as we've been conscious of awareness or of the psyche and all of that.
I don't know if you guys know the punk rock lead singer Henry Rollins. He once said that life is a video game that you survive, and it's if you not to view your life as a game, but to be like Mr. Ohm is saying, to be interested in your life, to be interested in your destiny, to have a telesis, as the CTMU calls it. And the CTMU will if more and more people, Tommy, go to understand the CTMU, and let's say the Compatriots grows to 50 members in the next year, and then we have like a vanguard, and we have this like we're having now talks, like we're having now in the future, many iterations of these talks. If we spread this out over 2 to 4 years in the future, I think you can only think in 5-year horizons, practically speaking. But in 20 years, you can imagine that this is going to distribute to tens of thousands of people, and then maybe 100,000 people, and more and more. And the paper itself has been downloaded millions of times, right? Like they say that Chris Langen's individual papers get like 50 downloads a day per paper. That's what it says in one of the footnotes on the back of his book. The way I see it is the Compatriots, I have a plan that I think the Compatriots, I'm so glad we're all Compatriots at this point, but it grows to be 100 people in 4 years. And then maybe it tightens up. Maybe the discipline gets more intense. Maybe individual cells break off and do their own work. And then we have a vanguard movement of the CTMU, because it is a theory of everything. And I'm really happy, Mr. Trapp, to have your work kind of integrated into this. The CTMU is a theory of everything. And so there should be overlap between your work and the CTMU in the future that we can flush out later, you know? So, yeah.
Yeah, and also 100 content creators, 100 people.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who are putting that out. And that's kind of where I was trying to go with that line of questioning, is what are the four, with a view not to just what ought to be done, but what are the four of us going to do? What is the Compatriots going to do? What is the broader movement going to do with respect to the interdisciplinary applications of the CTMU and instructional material and seminars, etc.
The nice thing is that each of us can focus, as we have been, on our individual initiative and our individual field of study. Mr. Ohm will continue to be an editor of his magazine for the foreseeable future, and he will bring his ideas back to the CTMU. Mr. Coleman will grow in his knowledge of his own work, and then bring that back to the CTMU. Hopefully there's more conversations. My focus is managing the Compatriots. And Tommy, you've laid out an ambitious curriculum that you want to get. Your brilliant conception of bringing an 18-year-old from zero understanding to fundamentals. Fundamentals is so important of any discipline, whether you're studying physics or medicine or anything. Learning the fundamentals is so important. I think that your course, bringing a guide to fundamentals, is so important. I'm more of a hipster. I'm concerned with culture. I'm concerned with people doing well and Christian leadership in a sort of way. And Christian leadership, what does it look like? It looks like Jesus washing the feet of his disciples. That's what Christian leadership looks like. And that's what I hope to emulate in my personal tasks. So, yeah.
Yeah, if you want everybody to speak on that point. I mean, like I say at the very big, at the first, you know, gratitude to you, Greg, to put this together, because yeah, that's always, especially in our day and age and kind of 2023, you know, there's isolation, we're extreme isolation, right? And what needs to happen is groups need to form to discuss all that they find passion. I think the CTMU is such a great place to be, bring the right people together to talk about their ideas and grow something, right? But yeah, these groups right here, we're not sure what we'll get out of them, but I just know deep in my heart that they'll bring something very important to each of us, because we each need this avenue to kind of spitball. And like, I'm already processing a lot of what Coleman has already said.
Yeah.
And now my gears are turning. How do I think of that? How do I think of my world of the German new medicine, biological programs, from the context of what he's bringing? Yes, yeah. It's just expansive. You know what I mean? And it doesn't happen unless these kinds of things happen. So I encourage people to do this more often. And people like you, Greg, are absolutely essential to make it happen. Otherwise, we just become myopically focused. This is so easy to do.
Yeah. Thank you very much. And Mr. Coleman, we owe you a debt for you're kind of an outsider right now, but we hope to bring you into the family of the CTMU. Whether or not I've learned more talking to Tommy and talking to different, like, other guys in the group and the compatriots, like Quest Brown, who understand CTMU better. I don't understand CTMU to the extent that these guys do, but I've learned so much just by opening up dialogue with them. And so whether you study the CTMU or not, or if you just talk to us in the group, then I think the integration will come. And you can let, and this group exists not to impede individual initiative. Each of you stay focused on your field, your research, and you bring that richness back. And we hope to make more content producers in the group, so that when we have these 100 guys in the group, maybe 75 of them produce content and the rest have other uses, you know. And then they could, like I said, they can break off into cells. It may be that each one of us joins a different cell in the future, but we all come back to the center at the end, you know. We like, maybe we get more guys interested in medicine, they join you, John Ohm, or we get more guys interested in biblical techniques and digital archaeology, and they join you, Coleman, you know. So that's what I hope for in the future.
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm trying to get with I published a piece on my Substack. Is if you have a group of people with that, who are like-minded and towards a common mission, that you can form, and this gets to the interdisciplinary aspect of the CTMU, is that you can form what Malcolm Gladwell called, because this was based on his book, The Tipping Point, is a transactional memory system, that you can have these subgroups of, you know, these are the physics people and this is the medicine people, and they're able to interact with each other and have all these interdisciplinary things. Whereas, you know, I can't be a PhD in 10 different subjects, but I can have, if I'm in a group with people with a PhD in 10 different subjects, then I'm going to get their expertise on everything. And so, and also to that point, you can massively increase the efficacy. You could have, let's say, 75% of the people are content producers. The other 25% could be, you know, video editors, branding, marketing people, you know, strategic, organizational people.
We have a guy in our group right now that's a logistics guy for marketing. Mm-hmm. And so maybe we don't have a use for him right now, but we have in 5 years, all of a sudden we're distributing books, and all of a sudden it becomes useful. Yeah. I like what you're saying about the living network. Like, we're each individual mind siloed by itself can't do much. But when you have a network of, you can text somebody 15 different people, and one's, like you're saying, either an expert in philosophy or medicine or biblical digital archaeology, biblical techniques, you text them and then you get an immediate response and you have access to their brain. Yep. It's like a network, right? It's fascinating, yeah.
Yeah, and it goes to show, I mean, I think what Chris Langan kind of foresees the CTMU to be is that overarching framework from which you can understand any of your specific kind of points of view, even on these like big philosophical divides, you know, the Einstein-Bohm versus Heisenberg divide in quantum physics, right? Well, you can understand both equally in the CTMU, and then it kind of makes illusory the division there. It's like, oh, okay. Yeah. You know what I mean? So it brings people together inherently, but it also nests people accordingly to a bigger overarching framework of reality. I mean, it doesn't get bigger than that.
Yeah. I call it the Institute of All Science, the CTMU. Mm-hmm. Chris Lang calls it the foundational language. I think that's a good way to put it, the foundational language, because it's like this blueprint that exists for all of us. But then further, if you're looking at establishing an institute, like a body, a corporate body of people that work on something, that's why I call it an Institute of All Science, essentially.
Yeah, that's fitting for sure.
Yeah, and then Coleman, I guess I don't know if you have any comment or kind of elaboration on that. We just talked about a lot of stuff related to that.
Yeah, something that's standing out to me is what John Ohm brought about, like, healing not necessarily being just fixing these problems for people, but maybe finding a way to motivate or encourage them to figure it out. Because I know that's an oversimplification of it, but It's like if nature or God or reality is trying to teach us lessons, then it would be a shame to remove that opportunity. And so if we healed all the sickness and made it where everybody lasted forever, but we all still didn't like each other, that sounds pretty miserable. It's like no science is going to make it where you want to be compassionate to somebody who bothers you. That's like, that's something where nature has to just beat you into submission over the course of a lifetime. But that being said, yeah, it's almost like nature is raising children. And if you think about a child, like they don't know necessarily why you're telling them to look both ways when they cross the street. It would look very painful and awkward, you know, if your parent grabs your arm and says, you know, says sternly, don't look both ways. Please look both ways. That might be close to what disease or sickness is. It's like us being brought up as children of, as highly complex, beloved children of Mother Nature. So yeah, I love how simple that is. So as far as like an interdisciplinary future, for me, it is so inherently interdisciplinary that to start to pick apart how it's interdisciplinary is the same thing as doing all the work. Hmm. Like I feel like it would take a book to pull that apart. One thing that, like, I think, Tommy, you would be the most probably, you'd probably be the best at answering that because you might have the deepest understanding of the CTMU of the four of us. So I know some about it, you know, listening to Kurt Jaimungal's interview with Chris Langham and seeing some other interviews and doing a little bit of digging, looking at watching some of Tommy's videos and some of yours as well. But yeah, first, there's a lot of redefining language. And so if I had a holistic understanding of the first principles that he's building everything off of, like that, I think that would go really far.
Get to work, Tommy.
As we're kind of closing this particular session, like what do you want your message, each of you, to be to be for this kind of first step into one, organizing the Compatriots and then the broader CTMU movement, as well as the interdisciplinary applications of the CTMU in general? Just if you have any closing words.
You want to go, John?
Yeah, okay, let me try that one. Yeah, I mean, I'm encouraging everybody to come together and to share their minds. And you know, as far as I'm concerned with my specialty or what I'm very focused on, it is health. And you know, health is a really broad term. We all kind of want health. You can understand the word health to mean many things. You know, it's holism and integration and what we want. Okay, so ultimately we all do want health. So all of our interdisciplinary approaches are going to connect in the end. You know, they're all reaching to the same goal. You know, it is the teleological prime identity goal, whatever that is. Okay, it's the dance of life. But yeah, my kind of closing remarks here, bringing the germ medicine into the equation, you know, I really do just encourage people to start to think about their body from this new context, learn the germ medicine and how it does shift on a major level from a mechanistic approach to biology, that biology is just a machine where you need to feed it the right inputs, right? And disease is just a breakdown process of the body due to some kind of choices in life relative to the machinery. And that's the old paradigm. There's the new paradigm. And the new paradigm is including the psyche, the brain, and the organs of the body, and understanding this new pattern of biology, of conflicts and their resolution and those effects on the body. And the main question that, you know, I think of in philosophy and my own personal meditations on this is the question of what constitutes a biological conflict shock, because that's ultimately what initiates this whole biological process. And it's defined by Hammer as an unexpected. That's the most important thing. It's something that takes us by surprise. He would use the words catches us on the wrong foot, okay? But it's an unknown. It's an unexpected surprise, all right? And it's a distressing emotional experience. And it supersedes our nervous systems or our biology's normal way of comprehending a problem. Hence the biological program of adaptation to lift us to a new level to try to overcome this problem or comprehend the problem. So the question that I'm on is, what is the nature of shock and surprise to the human organism within the context of reality and reality theory, okay, and consciousness, all right? That's where I'm at. That's where I encourage people to bring it in and come up with your own ideas, okay? And yeah, the ultimate goal here is to grow our psyche and our comprehensibility of life in a general sense. But I really believe that, you know, with the application of the germ of new medicine and these new discoveries, we're going to have great personal, family, social advances in real life health and well-being. I mean, and talk about the independence that gives you with respect to a system that you might otherwise be dependent on. So, you know, hello system. Okay, here we are. But in any case, you know, that's what I encourage you to do. There's so many points of interest with the germ of new medicine. Once you really study it and get that overview, you bring it into your own personal investigations with this philosophy, with the CTMU, bring our minds together on this topic. It will flower in many of your own personal endeavors.
Do you want to answer the question, Mr. Trapp?
Yeah, my mind was just going off of everything you were saying, John. So good. I feel like this is going to be a challenge to tie it all into a final thought. I think to help me out, Tommy, will you ask me the question again so I can start from scratch?
Yeah, what is, well, it's just kind of open. It's just, what is your message as we're closing for, obviously, this is the first step of the CTMU Compatriots group, et cetera, and having kind of a concrete existence and presence in for the CTMU movement, and for, you can also touch on the interdisciplinary aspects of the CTMU as well, and the future of the group, the movement, etc.
Yeah, enjoy the ride. Okay. I think there's definitely a lot about this that's out of our control. Have y'all heard of the Qualia Research Institute?
Yep.
So there's a video that was posted on there about this gentleman who has his theory of cognition, and it has to do with waves throughout the body, that like these different patterns of waves throughout the entire body, bioelectric system, not just the brain. So what's the word he uses? It's not equanimity. It's like this thing where your nervous system doesn't tense up with a harsh input. Like that's like peace. Like if we could not be surprised, even though that, you know, that takes some of the fun out of it. Another thing that was running through my mind as John was speaking was that question he posed of, like, this is where I'm at, is like, what is the nature of that which humans don't expect that would catch them on the wrong foot? The dragon of chaos might be the most primordial human archetype in the psyche, that idea of the walled garden, the place of understanding, and then the journey out into chaos. And chaos is a shapeshifter by definition. It's a shapeshifting beast, because you can get used to going out into the wilderness to find the unknown. And then you come home and someone inside of your tribe gets cancer, and that's a whole other type of unknown. Or somebody could have subversive plans to destroy your community from within. So it's this alertness which takes tension to a degree to focus and concentrate. There's this inherent tension, and so it's like the soft focus, because you have to focus But if you're focused too much on the wrong thing, then when you get hit from the side, it's even more of an offense. So that's like a, that's not, I guess, not a direct answer to your question, Tommy. The more direct answer would be, yeah, keep on keeping on, because there's obviously something massive happening with Earth and humanity, if we're involved or not. So I think it's an honor that we get to partner with nature and with each other and have these conversations, because I see, yeah, I'll also tie it into energy efficiency, because I feel like the ability to use energy in an efficient manner, like the word harmony was brought up really early on in this conversation. A harmonic machine is one that's energy efficient, and it's one that lasts a long time. A machine that's built with proper proportions is one that needs less repair. And so, yeah, you know, I wish I had something fancy to say, because, like, from my own experience, you can't force it. Like, I had people telling me for most of my life to surrender and to submit, and I reached a point where I was so miserable, and I was just like, I want to surrender, I want to submit, and I was crying out, like, how do I submit, how do I surrender? And then that's what grace is. It's like nature came and surrendered me. God came and submitted me. So it's like it wasn't up to me in the final analysis. And so that's where the wonder comes from. That's where the humility comes from. And so I see this more as an honor that we get to partner with God and have these conversations. And yeah, responsibility is a word that I used to hate, but I love now, because it's the ability to respond. And so we're doing our work so that when the call comes, we're able to respond, to say, here I am.
That's beautiful.
So yeah, I know that wasn't clear or concise, but that's all I got.
Yeah. I'll say for as far as I'm concerned with the group and the CTMU, is that Da Vinci had a slogan called Relentless Rigor. Relentless rigor, just and I believe we're all at work in our own lives, but that also has to be paired, as so many people have told me, with love and fellowship. It's a spiritual movement. It's not just about rah-rah, fight the enemy. It's more about, we do this for the right reasons. So relentless rigor, we're working hard, and we're doing it in fellowship and love, and we're on the march right now, I'll say.
Yep, that's true. You talk about the law of attraction. That's true to a sense, but you need intelligence and discipline to actually take a vision in your mind and make that into concrete reality through the fruit of your labor. And then you need that spirit of love and wisdom and understanding to make sure that that's going in the right direction, because you can be intelligent and disciplined for a military contractor, but that's not going to create much goodness in the world. So just to everyone who is still watching, I just hope that, you know, there's going to be so much more great stuff coming out of this group. So many more conversations, and, you know, just buckle in. It'll be a great ride. So thank you, guys. God bless.
God bless.
All of you. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.